We planted the church in Latin.
And pause in the presence of God.
Thank you. Thank you. Greetings, everyone. It's fantastic to be here this afternoon. This is, in a sense, my first engagement for... Sorry, I'm trying to cut my mic.
This is the day which the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad.
I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I am sure that he is able to guard until that day what he has entrusted to them. Hear the teaching of Christ. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you. Hear God's word to all who turn to Christ. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. God has promised forgiveness to all who truly repent, turn to Christ in faith, and are themselves forgiven. In silence, we call to mind our sins. Let us confess our sins. Merciful God, we have sinned in what we have thought and said, in the wrong we have done, and in the good we have not done. We have sinned in ignorance. We have sinned in weakness. We have sinned through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry. We repent and turn to you. Forgive us for our Saviour Christ's sake, and renew our lives to the glory of your name. Amen.
Through the cross of Christ, God have mercy on you, pardon you and set you free. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. God strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in life eternal.
Amen. Would you please stand to say together the Gloria in the Chalice? Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
And let us pray together. Convert us, Jesus the persecuted, as you converted Paul and sent him as apostle to the world. May our love, our prayers, our suffering carry your gospel at whatever cost to all who wait to hear it. Hear this prayer for your name's sake. Amen.
Please be seated. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 9, beginning at the first verse. Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they heard the voice but saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight, and neither ate nor drank. Now there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias." He answered, "Here I am, Lord." The Lord said to him, "Get up and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment he is praying, and he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him, so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who invoke your name. But the Lord said to him, Go, for he is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings and before the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name. So Ananias went and entered the house. He laid his hands on Saul and said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on your way here, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And immediately, something like scales fell from his eyes, and his sight was restored. Then he got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. For several days he was with the disciples in Damascus, and immediately he began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogue, saying, He is the Son of God. All who heard him were amazed and said, Is not this the man who made havoc in Jerusalem among those who invoked this name? And has he not come here for the purpose of bringing them bound before the chief priests? Saul became increasingly more powerful and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus was the Messiah. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Amen. according to Matthew chapter 19, beginning at verse 23.
Praise and glory to God.
Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Truly, I tell you, it will be hard for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." When the disciples heard this, they were greatly astounded and said, "Then who can be saved?" But Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but for God all things are possible." Then Peter said in reply, "Look, we have left everything and followed you. What then will we have?" Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, at the renewal of all things, when the Son of Man is seated on the throne of his glory, you who have followed me all will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left the houses, or brothers, or sisters, or father, or mother, or children, or fields, for my name's sake, will receive a hundredfold and will inherit eternal life. But many who are first, last, and the last will be first." This is the Gospel of Christ.
Praise Christ for you.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. Thank you for joining us. If you're joining us here or online, so welcome to be have you here joining us. Today we're in Acts chapter 9, and we're going from verse 1 to chapter 2, and it's about Saul's conversion, but I thought a more suitable title for what I'm going to share about is called "Guess Who's Coming to Church." It's kind of Jesus saying to his whole church, "Look who I have invited," and I'm imagining they would all have been pretty shocked. So this afternoon I'm going to start by looking at Saul's invitation to the church family, and then I'm going to hand it over to Andy Miller, who's our mission partner at St. John's, who's going to share a bit about the Ananias figure of this story and some testimony and stories of what he's experienced through his years in doing mission work. So as I was preparing for today's message, I looked at the first 10 chapters in the book of Acts. And it became pretty clear that there's a central theme of God calling into his family the people that we would least expect. This theme goes all the way back to the beginning of the Old Testament. The first of God's chosen people was a guy named Abraham, who was an idol worshipper. And it continues with the story of Joseph, the runt of the litter, the last one who I think we would have picked, but God chose him anyways. You see the same thing in David, who became a famous king. It continues through the Old Testament prophets time after time, and it continues in the New Testament, when Mary and Joseph show up. A poor young couple from the wrong side of the tracks, with a scandalous rumor about the child that she's about to bear. And it continues on. When Jesus picks his apostles, untrained men from Galilee, like who in the world are these people? And as Jesus goes to heaven and builds his church, in the first 10 chapters of Acts, it continues right along. And so I want to take a step back for a moment and look at these first 10 chapters. We find 5 surprising invitees who, at least at that point, everyone would have considered unworthy and undeserving of God's mercy and grace. The first one would be the prosecuting priests in chapter 4. We see that when the church was meeting every day on the temple steps, and they were explaining how Jesus is the Messiah, and they were praying, and then the priests began to persecute them. The priests told them to shut up, and scatter. And when they didn't do that, they had them arrested. They turned them over and they had them beaten. And yet a couple of chapters later, by Acts chapter 6, we discovered that a large group of those priests had become Jesus followers. But it gets even more surprising. By the time we get to Acts chapter 8, God is inviting into his family the Samaritans. For over 700 years, there'd been an intense mutual hatred between the Jews and the Samaritans. The Samaritans were considered spiritual half-breeds. They had their own Bible, a cut-and-paste version of the scripture, where only parts were there. They had their own priesthood, their own temple, and a Jew would do anything he could not to even go through the territory, which made Jesus talking to a Samaritan woman all the more shocking in John chapter 4, or the use of the Good Samaritan as a positive example. So after we have the priests and the Samaritans, we find a foreigner, and a unique one at that. He is known as the Ethiopian eunuch. And here's a guy that would not have even been allowed into the temple to worship God, yet the Lord sends Philip and says, invite him in as well. And he goes back to Ethiopia, and the gospel is spread that way. Then we come to the fourth one, which is the one we're going to dig into in a bit more detail today. God says, by the way, I also want a sworn enemy to become part of my family. Saul had prosecuted Christians, he had jailed him, he had been part of the murder of some. He was a bad guy and he hated Christians. He pursued Jesus' followers, and then Jesus pursued him and saved him. And shockingly, we're going to see that Jesus not only saves him, but he puts Saul in a leadership position. No one in the early church would have thought that this was possible. The last of these five shocking invitees is a guy named Cornelius. The Jews wanted nothing to do with Gentiles. They were even worse than the Samaritans. A good Jew would never even eat with or go into the same house as a Gentile. They were considered to be created for destruction, yet God says, nope, I want them in the family too. With that little bit of overview and understanding, we see a God who pursues the ones we might be pretty shocked to see at church. I want to stop and take a step back, and I want to spend the rest of our time in light of these five invitees. Especially God's call to Saul. And I want us to look at it through four lessons through this passage. And I want to start with the first one. It says, we do not get to pick our brothers and sisters. Jesus gets to choose. It's his family, it's his church, it's his kingdom, not ours. And the fact of the matter is, when we go, oh, not him, not her, Lord, we're going, they're not worthy. They don't deserve it. This means we have completely forgotten who we were or who we are. I want to show you a couple of verses about how worthy we are and how deserving we are. One from the Old Testament and one from the New. The first one is in Isaiah chapter 64, verse 6, where we are told that all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. And I want to highlight this. The prophet here is saying, you know you do some good stuff, but I want to tell you the best of your best, all of your righteous works, if you pile them together and you put them in the presence of God's holiness, they're like filthy rags. You see, sometimes we make the wrong comparison and we get the wrong idea. We look around at other people and maybe you are more righteous than other people. Good on you. But you start to think, I'm pretty righteous because the people you are comparing your righteousness with are other people and not with the glory of God. Because when I compare it with other people, I think I'm worthy, I deserve it, but we don't. But when we compare it with God, I just go, oh my gosh, I'm a mess. The other passage is from Romans chapter 3, verse 24. You might know this one. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's not one of us who has lived a life worthy enough to stand in the presence of the Lord without being consumed by his righteousness and holiness. Not because we have an angry God, but because we have a holy and righteous God, and sin is not in his presence. That's what we forget when we think we get to choose our brothers and sisters. Let's be real. When we think somebody is undeserving and unworthy, it's because of their past or maybe their present, or they don't have everything together just yet. We tend to think those who think like us, who have come to understand what I've come to understand, they belong. And when we drive into church and we see a bumper sticker from the other side of the issue, we just go, how could a Christian believe that? And say, I'm so angry. How can these kind of people be at church? I've lost my spot. We're supposed to have mature and immature people. We're supposed to have people who are here and over there. And here's the reason why. Because Jesus is greater than all our differences and all our divisions. When Jesus chooses his inner circle, he gave us a model of the church that he wants. We don't get to pick our brothers and sisters, and we don't earn our way into the family. Every one of us was adopted into this family by his grace and his mercy. And if we're not careful, we'll forget that. The second thing I want us to remember from the story is that no one is too bad or too broken to join God's family. And in fact, in my life and in your life, we've all got some people we think are too bad or too broken. Saul is more intense. He was an arch enemy, a personal enemy. For instance, Ananias, remember him from the story? He's done great personal harm to Ananias. As far as we know, Ananias either had relatives or himself had to flee Jerusalem. He had his friends had been put in jail, in prison, and killed. And Saul had showed up to Damascus with every intention to do that to him. He drove them out of Jerusalem, helped murder Stephen. He relentlessly pursued these Christians. But the weird thing is, Jesus didn't just say, well, I want him in the family as well. Jesus didn't just save Saul, he put him in leadership. Remember Acts chapter 9? The Lord said, go to this man, he is my chosen instrument. The one that has scared you to death, the one that has been destroying everything you stand for, he is my chosen instrument. And here is what he's going to do. He's going to proclaim my name, he's going to be my ambassador, my spokesman to the Gentiles of all people, to their kings and to the people of Israel. And we now know him as Paul the Apostle, the writer of many of the New Testament letters. Who would have guessed that? I want to ask you this question. Who is your soul? Who scares you to death? Or even personally has brought you harm? Who scares you to death politically? Who scares you to death in the marketplace? Who has been unfair to you? Has created harm in your life? Your family? Who is your soul? And here's the question that goes with that. Is our response more like Jonah when God sent him? Or is our response like Ananias? Because I've heard some conversations of church folk. And we need to be more honest in our conversations and more ways in life groups and among friends. Because if we're honest, we're a lot more like Jonah than we are like Ananias. The third thing I want us to look at is we are supposed to give to others what God gave us. We owe people undeserved grace and mercy. Is this not our calling? We owe people undeserved grace and mercy. It's not a suggestion. It's a requirement. Jesus died for us while we were still his enemies. And he asked us to do that to others. Grace and mercy is something they don't deserve. Because if I give you grace or some favor or some blessing and you deserve it, it's not grace, it's just your wages. You earned it. And if I give you mercy because you've done that or you've taken these steps, it's not mercy, it's just justice. You see, grace and mercy by definition can't have a but first do this and then that. They're not earned, and we didn't earn them ourselves. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11, it says, do not be deceived, and then it lists this whole bunch of sins. And I guess when we read that, we go, yeah, all of those people don't deserve the kingdom. And then in verse 11, it goes, and that is what some of you were. And all of a sudden, we keep quiet. That is who we were before we were washed and sanctified and justified in the name of the Lord. That's what I love about our Sunday services as Anglicans, is the time of confession. It reminds us that we've all sinned and fallen short, but it's not by our works that we are saved, but by the grace and the mercy of God, and we've got to remember that. The fourth thing out of this story is the only way to think and act like this is if we have a renewed mind. We've got to renew our minds. Because at the moment there is this kind of thinking in a cancel culture world where we're so ready to write people off, to spread the slander and the rumors, or whatever they did that was out of step. We start pursuing the priests that persecuted us, pursuing the Samaritans who hated our guts and have treated us like trash forever. We start pursuing the Ethiopian eunuch, Saul, and pursuing the Gentiles, and everybody feels justified because we were wrong first, so we have the right. But we're called to align our values and our actions with Scripture, not culture. And we're called to represent Jesus. There's a time and a place for a cause, and things are important, but at the end of the day, people are even more important.
Yes.
All people are made in the image of God, even the souls who have harmed us greatly. Look at Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, which talks about the renewed mind. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, because of what he has done for us, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice to the Lord. So before I finish, I want to hand over to Andy to share a bit about the Ananias figure, who truly embodied this living sacrifice. Thank you, Andy.
Today, we are all Ananias. All of us. It's only a little piece, a little passage in Scripture that mentions Ananias. We don't know much about Ananias, except that he had a quiet time. He had a time with the Lord, and God said to him, Ananias, there is a guy that is praying who's got a vision that a person called Ananias is going to see. He didn't give him much option. And when he called Ananias to go, he uses the word go twice to Ananias. Ananias didn't go to another nation. We don't know much more of the life of Ananias. He crossed the road and went to Straight Street, to Judas's house. And today, guess who's coming to church? A month ago, I didn't know I was coming here. We are involved in partnering with the mission movement across the whole of Latin America that is aiming to reach Hindus, Muslims, Buddhists, animists, and atheists globally. As New Zealanders, we are a church born of mission. As the Anglican Church in New Zealand, the first Anglican missionaries were sent from New Zealand in 1899. In Latin America, we are in the first generation where the whole continent is being awakened to the call of God to nations. Like Ananias and like Peter, the norm for a Christian in the first generation was being willing to lay down your life. Peter says, Lord, we have laid down our lives. Ananias has been invited to speak, pray for healing over the persecutor of the Christians. He knew who Paul was. He knew his risks. And he is going to reach out to them. We have been back in Latin America. I grew up in Latin America. But we have been missionaries based in Costa Rica, working with the church leadership across the whole Latin America, and have been invited to be in the global leadership of mission movement from Latin America. One of the key leaders, his surname is Matamoros, which literally means Mata is killer, and Moros is Muslims, killer of Muslims. He has worked 20 years serving and loving the Muslim church worldwide, in Jordan, in Egypt, and globally. And God, just as he called Saul would call El Matamoros. And his surname, Muslim Killer, challenged him to be one that reaches and loves out to Muslims. Here in New Zealand, guess who's coming to church? I discovered in this last week, we have here Pastor Juan Farrugia from Chile in the third row, and my friend Marcos Leopoldo from Brazil. Both of them feel called to New Zealand. And are here, and I did not know they were in Timaru and Temuka. When I came to New Zealand this year, they asked me, could you create a network of Latin Americans that God is placing in different places of the world? And could you do that in New Zealand? And today is the first day that they have connected together here in this gathering place. We're going to have a picnic afterward. I would really encourage you to meet with them. But God has been bringing people from different nations to New Zealand. Recently in Afghanistan, there are refugees that are now coming here. There are people from all over the world that are your neighbors, and you can be Ananias to them. I think of Mauricio, a very close friend of mine. I met him in a supermarket. They were buying potatoes. They were saying, compramos estas papas o no compramos estas papas? Are we buying these potatoes? Should we not buy these potatoes? I said to them, compre estas papas, from where are papas? Buy these potatoes, they're good potatoes. I said to them in Spanish, 10 kgs of potatoes? They wash the potatoes here. You can have them washed or unwashed. This is back and say, you might as well get them. Mauricio had come to New Zealand to try and get a better life. With his girlfriend, they were living together, they weren't married, they came over here, they met Pastor Juan in his church, and were challenged by the Holy Spirit, they came to Christ, they got married, and he was a very new Christian. I was working at the time with Voice of the Martyrs, speaking about Christians facing persecution globally. We started a little Spanish church in Christchurch, and the first time I preached, he came up in tears, saying, I've got to do something. At the time, the directors of Voice of the Martyrs, Graham Gallen and his wife, were going to Sumner Anglican Church. And they welcomed him in and sponsored him, trained him up to set up Voice of the Martyrs in Chile. Together with Pastor Juan, that you oversaw it, they set up Voice of the Martyrs in Chile. Today, he's a director across the whole of Latin America. But he came to Christ here in New Zealand as people reached out to him. We recently, a few weeks ago, we went to Invercargill, where a friend of mine, who is now called Matthew McDonald, his real name is Amr, he's from Saudi Arabia, he became a Christian because somebody spoke to him on Facebook for 2 years. And then, a family who were retired were teaching English as a second language in Bahrain, and when he moved to Bahrain and he wanted to find out about the gospel, they loved him so much that he took their name when he came to Christ. He had to leave, and he didn't know where to go, and he ended up in New Zealand. I met him when he first arrived over here in 2010. This year, he is planning to go to Mexico to help train Latin Americans reach people in the Middle East. But his experience of coming to Christ, being discipled, and being loved by a Kiwi family was here in New Zealand. And this last year, during the lockdown, I couldn't travel and preach in different places, so we decided to set up prayer groups at 5:30 in the morning and 8 at night, and different little prayer groups, and we did a Facebook meeting where I would speak for half an hour, and I decided to mention it on my Facebook chat one day. And a friend of mine from school, the worst behaved boy in the whole school, Charlie, who had been in prison and on the street for 20 years, had just come out of prison, decided to join that prayer meeting. And he stayed in that prayer meeting for the whole year. He's not yet joined the church. That prayer meeting has become his church. But he's now got a job. He's now back together with his wife. He has been growing, and God has been moving in his life. Because we reach out, and you are Ananias. As you partner with us, we partner with Latin America to see a fresh generation reaching the nations. And the question we ask is, are we welcoming people in? Can we? Yes, we can. Is God still calling people to reach out? Yes, they are. And who is he calling? Just the few? Just the people that go overseas? We think, and we look at, in the book of Acts, at Peter and at Paul. But the reality is, the gospel grew through ordinary, and it always has been the case, that the gospel grew through ordinary people. Dennis said today that going starts at the door of the church as we leave. And this is it. We are called to be Ananias. You and I are Ananias. And how exciting it is when we, like Ananias, decide to spend some time and say, God, here I am. Send me. Here I am. What do you want? And let hear from him. And it's such an adventure. Who knows who's coming to church through you?
I want to leave you with these two questions before we go up. It's going to build on that a bit. And if you can, I want you to write them down. They're pretty straightforward. The first one is, am I a recruiter or am I a bouncer? What is my knee-jerk response to the people I might disagree with? Am I a greeter inviting them in? Or am I a recruiter going after them? Or am I a bouncer telling them all the reasons why they don't belong? The question comes down to this. Do I define people by who they are or who they were? The lie of Satan is that we are what we did, and there's no room for change. We are forever locked into this. The incredible good news of Jesus is that it's paid for. It's paid in full, and you are who you are. You are not what you did. By this, we're not saying we're excusing what people do or giving them a free pass under the grace of God, but we choose to look past that. Which leads to the second question. The first one is about people who did things you disdain or despise in the past, and the second one is how you see people now. Questions: do I see a rock or do I see a sculpture? I want to share something that happened just this morning. And I believe the Holy Spirit was working through me. I woke up this morning and I went to St. John's to go pick up some stuff. And when I got there, the church garden in front of the church, someone had gotten into it and started ripping up plants and threw them all over the parking lot. And my immediate response was, these lowlifes, who do they think they are? I proceeded to clean up and putting everything away, and while doing that, the anger inside me got worse and worse. And when I got home, I took some photos and I posted it on Facebook. Looking at it now, that's probably a way I wanted some validation. And some of my sentiments, or the thoughts I had at the moment, were shared by some of the community. A couple of hours later, I received a call from the person who was responsible for it. And he was really apologetic and ashamed. He said he didn't want his kids to see what he had done. And he apologized and he offered to pay and fix for his mistakes. And in that moment, the Holy Spirit spoke in my heart, convicting me for thinking the worst and just seeing the ugly rock instead of the sculpture. So imagine you're Leonardo da Vinci or some other great sculpture. They would look at this rock and in their mind, they could step back and see the sculpture that would come out of it. I want to tell you that Saul did not look anything like an apostle or the writer of the Bible. Most of us would have seen an ugly rock, but that's not what Jesus saw. And so I ask myself, what is my knee-jerk response? Am I a recruiter or a bouncer? Do I have a knee-jerk response where I go, no, they are just an ugly rock? Or do I think the best of people when they take their first step forward and they haven't taken all the steps yet? there might be a beautiful sculpture in there. Because none of us are worthy, Saul wasn't worthy, and the lesson from his life is a lesson from the heart of God. He's a recruiter, he's a lover of the lost, who takes rebels and rejects and turns them into royalty. And once he's done that to us, he asks us to have the same attitude and the same hearts towards everyone we come across. Father, I ask you to take the things we've looked at today and grow us up in it. Our ability to truly be not like the culture, but be transformed by the renewed minds that is aware of a reality that our world doesn't see. To your fame and your glory. Amen.
As people arrived at St. Mary's, they were invited to put their fingerprints on what is now going to become our altar frontal. Regan the Funker is going to bring it forward. One moment. People put fingerprints on this altar frontal, making flax flowers, which is set against a scene which depicts our South Canterbury area. In a New Zealand prayer book, there is a song of praise that gives thanks for the wild places and the bush, for the mountains, the coast and the sea. And it goes on to offer thanks and praise to God for this good land, for its trees and pastures and its plentiful crops. Words which are beautifully evocative of our South Canterbury district, from the Waitaki to the Rangitata and from the coast to Aoraki, Mount Cook. And as we pray today, we pray for this district. We also pray for the world. And the Bible, symbolising the faith we have to share in our area and across the world. Let us pray. Loving God, we are blessed to live in this good land. Give us thankful hearts and plant your peace so deep within us that the challenges of this time cannot destroy our joy in you. We pray for our South Canterbury parishes and ministry units and the communities we serve. We pray for Pukaki Parish, Mackenzie, Geraldine, Tanawa, Temuka, the Timaru parishes of Markfield, St. John's and St. Mary's, and for Waimate. We pray for the Timaru Hospital Chaplaincy, Craighead Diocesan School, Glenwood Home, and Anglican Care South Canterbury. We thank you for all the opportunities we have to impact others for good. Reinvigorate us, so we, in the power of your Holy Spirit, may live out and speak out the gospel with renewed urgency and love. Compassionate God, we hold before you those who are struggling in our communities, especially those impacted by COVID-19. We pray for those who have lost jobs, businesses, and opportunities. We pray for families and friendships that have fractured. We pray for farmers whose crops remain unharvested in their fields. We pray for all who fear COVID and those readying themselves to help our communities meet it. We pray for all across Aotearoa New Zealand who are ill, not only with COVID, and those awaiting answers. We pray for the world and the worldwide church. We pray for the people of Tonga as they grapple with the aftermath of the volcanic eruption and tsunami. We pray for the Diocese of Polynesia and for Anglican Missions, Christian World Service and other agencies as they seek to respond to needs for water, food and shelter and support the rebuilding of homes and infrastructure in Tonga. God of peace, we pray for the people of Ukraine and those who live on the Russian side of the border, as troops gather and tensions rise. Give those with influence wisdom, and guide all who will listen to you into your ways of justice and peace. With the International Anglican Communion, we pray today for the province of the Indian Ocean, and the churches of Madagascar, Mauritius, and Seychelles, as they bear witness to you in their island nations east of Africa. Empower and enliven their Bishop James Wong and all who offer leadership, serve, and share faith in that area. We pray too for Costa Rica and the countries of Central America, and for Andy and Shona as they mobilize Latin Americans into mission. We pray for their children, Aliana, Jeshiah, and Elias, and ask your blessing and strength for the family. We pray too for our own friends and families here and around the world. In a moment of quiet, we hold before you those in special need. And we pray for ourselves, for our needs and our ministries, that we may be like Ananias, prepared to go whatever the challenge when you call. Praise to you, abundant God, for when we ask, you give. When we seek, you show the way. When we knock, you answer. Praise to you for your unfailing grace. Make us now your faithful people. Amen.
Thank you.
let's stand for a moment. I'm going to ask Ashley Kindred to come forward, and Murray Gibson is going to present her as I commission Kindred to be, commission Kindred to be our new Deputy Vicar General in the Diocese of Christchurch. Think of the role of Vicar General like this. If Omicron strikes me down, I've got a Vicar General and a Deputy Vicar General who can step in and do stuff. So we hope that doesn't happen. But there might be ordinary reasons why they need to step in when I'm having a holiday or something like that. Murray, over to you.
Bishop Peter, I present Archdeacon Andrea Alexander to be commissioned Deputy Vicar General in the Diocese of Christchurch.
Thank you. The Vicar General and Deputy Vicar General share in our common ministry. They advise and support the Bishop's Ministry of Oversight, Leadership and Pastoral Care. They may be asked to represent the bishop and diocese, both within the diocese and outside of the diocese, with an Anglican and ecumenical context of ministry and mission. And they may need to stand in for the bishop in matters of decision-making and authorisation, according to their canonically prescribed role. Andrea, will you commit yourself to the ministry of Deputy Vicar General as required from time to time and as governed by the canons of our church?
I will, and with God's help, I will faithfully carry out the duties and responsibilities that are committed to me.
Will you share with the Archdeacons, the diocesan staff, and with me the work of the diocese as together we seek God's kingdom and proclaim the good news of Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Andrea, receive this license. Accept its responsibilities, which are both mine and yours, in the name of God Most High. Serve faithfully and with love. Seek only the glory of God in the care of God's people in this Diocese of Christchurch. And let us pray. Holy and living God, you call men and women to serve you and to build up the body of Christ. Strengthen and equip your servant, Andrea, as she cares for your church and builds up the body of Christ. May she serve you and this diocese with humility and love, ministering as a true servant of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. And so I present to you our new Deputy Vicar General. Let's welcome her to the role with a round of applause. Thank you, Andrea. While we remain standing, we continue in our service as we draw together in the peace of Christ in preparation for the sacrament. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Heir to Fano, we are the body of Christ.
By one Spirit, we are ties to one body.
Keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace.
Amen. We are bound by the love of Christ.
You're invited to turn where you are and share a contactless sign of peace with one another. Thank you.
Hello, you could do a roll.
Roll.
Does it go?
Okay.
Then we continue with our offertory.
Thank you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to offer thanks and praise.
Honour and worship are indeed your due, our Lord and our God. Through Jesus Christ, you created all things. By your will they were created, and for your glory they have their being. In your loving purpose, you chose us before the foundation of the world to be your people. You gave your promises to Abraham and Sarah, and bestowed your favour on the Virgin Mary. We give you thanks for the example and encouragement of your saints, especially St. Paul, for their witness to the truth of your gospel, and for the hope of glory which we share with them. Above all, we give you thanks and praise for your grace in sending Jesus Christ, not for any merit of our own, but when we had turned away from you. We were bound in sin, but in your compassion you redeemed us, reconciling us to yourself with the precious blood of Christ. In your Son you suffered with us and for us, offering us the healing riches of salvation and calling us to freedom and wholeness. Therefore, with people of every nation, tribe, and language, with the whole church on earth and in heaven, joyfully we give you thanks and say,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
All glory and honour to you, God of grace, for you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, once for all on the cross to be the one perfect sacrifice for the sin of the world, that all who believe in him might have eternal life. The night before he died, he took bread, and when he had given you thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this to remember me. After supper, he took the cup, and when he had given you thanks, he gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it to remember me. Therefore, Heavenly Father, in this sacrament of the suffering and death of your Son, we now celebrate the wonder of your grace and proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come in glory.
Redeemer God, rich in mercy, infinite in goodness, we were far off until you brought us near, and our hands are empty until you fill them. As we eat this bread and drink this wine, through the power of your Holy Spirit, feed us with your heavenly food, renew us in your service, unite us in Christ, and bring us to your everlasting kingdom. By the depths and riches of your wisdom, O God, how unsearchable your judgments and untraceable your ways.
From you and through you and for you are all things. To you be the glory forever. Amen.
And as Christ teaches us, we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Draw near and receive the body and blood of our Saviour Jesus Christ in remembrance that he died for us. Let us feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Yeah.